we see with the rise of childhood obesity leading into adult obesity, great importance in teaching our children healthy food habits and good nutrition.
Across America, from the mountain states to the Midwest, from the east and south, in sleepy towns and bustling cities, the work of Adventist Health System is defined by a unifying thread that winds through more than 150 years of a health and healing legacy. In the mid-1800s, health and long lives were rare. Good health care was practically non-existent, and doctors often prescribed odd elixirs and treatments, some of which were as harmful as the diseases they promised to cure. Nutritious food and clean water could help people stay healthier. They also proposed that a simple diet rich in nutritious foods would help build stamina and strength. Health reformers, led by James and Ellen White and other early Seventh-day Adventists, looked at the life of Jesus Christ and wanted to follow in his ways, caring for those who were hurting, physically, emotionally, and spiritually. With this mission in mind, these pioneers launched the Western Health Reform Institute in Battle Creek, Michigan, on September 5, 1866. They had limited staff, an 8-room house, and just one patient. They also had more faith than medical know-how, but they were determined and improve the work of the sanitarium. He was also a prolific inventor, developing procedures, surgical techniques, and medical equipment, much of which influenced the medical care we know today. In an effort to provide an easy and nourishing option to the typical unhealthy breakfast of that time, Kellogg ground corn and formed it into ready-to-eat flakes. His brother, who worked with him, later started the cereal company that still carries the family name today. Dr. Kellogg's expertise and innovations were widely known, and in the late 1800s through the early 1900s, the Battle Creek Sanitarium drew patients from around the world. Some of the most famous of these were John D. Rockefeller of Standard Oil, department store founder J.C. Penney, inventor Thomas Edison, African-American educator and author Booker T. Washington, and aviator Amelia Earhart. William Howard Taft, the 27th President of the United States, was the 100,000th patient of Dr. Kellogg and the Battle Creek Sanitarium. On a cold winter night in 1902, as Kellogg was out of town, the Battle Creek Sanitarium caught fire and burned to the ground. Undeterred by the disheartening news, Kellogg immediately boarded a train for Battle Creek. By the time he arrived, he had already sketched out plans for building a new and even grander sanitarium. This began an era of rapid development of like-minded institutions all over the country. Boulder Sanitarium in 1893, Hinsdale Sanitarium in 1905, and in that same year in Southern California, an abandoned hotel was purchased and Loma Linda Sanitarium was opened for care and medical education. Today, Loma Linda University Health ranks as one of the top-rated medical schools in the country. In 1908, Florida Sanitarium in Orlando was founded in faith by a small group of church members, including one person who mortgaged his own home for the down payment. Today, Adventist Health System employees, diverse in culture and backgrounds, find opportunities to provide highly advanced levels of care in a Christ-centered environment that encourages the health and healing of the whole person. Adventist Health System hospitals, outpatient centers, and nursing homes extend the healing ministry of Christ as far north as Wisconsin, as far west as Colorado, and as far south as Texas and Florida. Adventist Health System, reaching out, touching hearts, healing lives.
Mission Fit Possible program. We travel out into schools in Orange, Osceola, and Seminole counties, and we bring a really fun and interactive health and wellness program that focuses on food, mood, move, and recharge. We come out to the schools once a month for a full semester, and the kids get to know us as secret agents. So I'm Agent Erica, and we go on missions together. We uncover clues, we play games, we give out prizes. The kids get their very own Fit secret agent badge, and it's a really fun and interactive way for kids to learn holistic health and wellness.
What I love about Mission Fit is that it's not just another class that the kids go and see. It's something that it helps them learn while they're having a lot of fun. And I can see that they bring to the house, because when we come the next days or the next lesson, they come and tell us how they teach their parents how to read a label, how they teach their parents how to look for fruits or vegetables in an apple pie and see if that's part of the ingredients. So it's very rewarding.
So every week when they come, the kids are excited because they don't know what they're going to do. And within the lesson, it starts off with something educational, maybe sitting and learning about fruits and vegetables, but real quickly it turns into a game. And then from there it goes into exercise, and there's movement. And then they might bring them back and recap what they've learned. And with that exercise and movement, it keeps them engaged the whole time. And actually, they line up and they leave, and even in their classrooms, they're still calm and engaged because of their routine.
Well, this is the third year we've had the Mission Fit program here at Fern Creek, and it's an extraordinary program, really. A lot of our children live in what we would describe as a food desert. They don't have access in their neighborhood to a grocery store. Often it's just a convenience store where fresh fruits and vegetables aren't available to them. So we want our children to learn about fresh fruits and vegetables and how important they are in their diet.
So it's really exciting to see that what they're doing at school, and they're bringing it home and they're teaching it back to us. And they're asking to be active. They're asking to stay on the move. They're telling us about how sleep is important, and understanding that we set their bedtime for a reason, because it helps recharge them for the next day.
We see with the rise of childhood obesity leading into adult obesity, great importance in teaching our children healthy food habits and good nutrition.
So the students benefit by developing healthy habits. The schools benefit by having more focused students, and the community benefits by having a culture of health and wellness.
Okay, there we go. All right, testing podium mic. Testing podium mic. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Testing podium mic. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Testing podium mic. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. It's real low on the feed? Okay. Okay. Does that do anything? I doubt it. Testing podium mic. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. It's still low? Testing podium mic, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Let's see if I've got. Okay. Testing live, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Testing live, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. I can try to update, kick it up in there. There's individual settings. How does the laugh sound, though? So the laugh is fine for the live stream, then? Okay. Let me do. Let me raise the podium. Thank you.
which doesn't go any higher than me, but no one's as tall as me. But let me try this and see if it's any better.
Testing podium mic. Is that any better? You should have to be a little louder now. Okay.
Sunshine, rest, exercise, nutritious food, and clean water could help people stay healthier. They also proposed that a simple diet rich in nutritious foods would help build stamina and strength. Health reformers, led by James and Ellen White and other early Seventh-day Adventists, looked at the life of Jesus Christ and wanted to follow in his ways, caring for those who were hurting, physically, emotionally, and spiritually. With this mission in mind, these pioneers launched the Western Health Reform Institute in Battle Creek, Michigan, on September 5, 1866. They had limited staff, an 8-room house, and just one patient. They also had more faith than medical know-how, but they were determined to follow the Creator's footsteps. Pooling their resources, the church members managed to put several students through medical school. One was 23-year-old John Harvey Kellogg, who became medical director of the Institute in 1876 and changed its name to the Battle Creek Sanitarium. Dr. Kellogg was an avid reader who traveled the world to increase his medical knowledge and improve the work of the sanitarium. He was also a prolific inventor, developing procedures, surgical techniques, and medical equipment, much of which influenced the medical care we know today. In an effort to provide an easy and nourishing option to the typical unhealthy breakfast of that time, Kellogg ground corn and formed it into ready-to-eat flakes. His brother, who worked with him, later started the cereal company that still carries the family name today. Dr. Kellogg's expertise and innovations were widely known, and in the late 1800s through the early 1900s, the Battle Creek Sanitarium drew patients from around the world. Some of the most famous of these were John D. Rockefeller of Standard Oil, department store founder J.C. Penney, inventor Thomas Edison, African-American educator and author Booker T. Washington, and aviator Amelia Earhart. William Howard Taft, the 27th President of the United States, was the 100,000th patient of Dr. Kellogg and the Battle Creek Sanitarium. On a cold winter night in 1902, as Kellogg was out of town, the Battle Creek Sanitarium caught fire and burned to the ground. Undeterred by the disheartening news, Kellogg immediately boarded a train for Battle Creek. By the time he arrived, he had already sketched out plans for building a new and even grander sanitarium. This began an era of rapid development of like-minded institutions all over the country. Boulder Sanitarium in 1893, Hinsdale Sanitarium in 1905, and in that same year in Southern California, an abandoned hotel was purchased and Loma Linda Sanitarium was opened for care and medical education. Today, Loma Linda University Health ranks as one of the top-rated medical schools in the country. In 1908, Florida Sanitarium in Orlando was founded in faith by a small group of church members, including one person who mortgaged his own home for the down payment. Today, Adventist Health System employees, diverse in culture and backgrounds, find opportunities to provide highly advanced levels of care in a Christ-centered environment that encourages the health and healing of the whole person. Adventist Health System hospitals, outpatient centers, and nursing homes extend the healing ministry of Christ as far north as Wisconsin, as far west as Colorado, and as far south as Texas and Florida. Adventist Health System, reaching out, touching hearts, healing lives.
Mission Fit Possible program. We travel out into schools in Orange, Osceola, and Seminole counties, and we bring a really fun and interactive health and wellness program that focuses on food, mood, move, and recharge. We come out to the schools once a month for a full semester, and the kids get to know us as secret agents. So I'm Agent Erica, and we go on missions together. We uncover clues, we play games, we give out prizes. The kids get their very own Fit secret agent badge, and it's a really fun and interactive way for kids to learn holistic health and wellness.
What I love about Mission Fit is that it's not just another class that the kids go and see. It's something that it helps them learn while they're having a lot of fun. And I can see that they bring to the house, because when we come the next days or the next lesson, they come and tell us how they teach their parents how to read a label, how they teach their parents how to look for fruits or vegetables in an apple pie and see if that's part of the ingredients. So it's very rewarding.
So every week when they come, the kids are excited because they don't know what they're going to do. And within the lesson, it starts off with something educational, maybe sitting and learning about fruits and vegetables, but real quickly it turns into a game. And then from there it goes into exercise, and there's movement. And then they might bring them back and recap what they've learned. And with that exercise and movement, it keeps them engaged the whole time. And actually, they line up and they leave, and even in their classrooms, they're still calm and engaged because of their routine.
Good for our mood.
Well, this is the third year we've had the Mission Fit program here at Fern Creek, and it's an extraordinary program, really. A lot of our children live in what we would describe as a food desert. They don't have access in their neighborhood to a grocery store. Often it's just a convenience store where fresh fruits and vegetables aren't available to them. So we want our children to learn about fresh fruits and vegetables and how important they are in their diet.
So it's really exciting to see that what they're doing at school, and they're bringing it home and they're teaching it back to us. And they're asking to be active, they're asking to stay on the move, they're telling us about how sleep is important, and understanding that we set their bedtime for a reason because it helps recharge them for the next day.
We see with the rise of childhood obesity leading into adult obesity, great importance in teaching our children healthy food habits and good nutrition.
So the students benefit by developing healthy habits. The schools benefit by having more focused students, and the community benefits by having a culture of health and wellness.
Across America, from the mountain states to the Midwest, from the east and south, in sleepy towns and bustling cities, the work of Adventist Health System is defined by a unifying thread that winds through more than 150 years of a health and healing legacy. In the mid-1800s, health and long lives were rare. Good health care was practically non-existent, and doctors often prescribed odd elixirs and treatments, some of which were as harmful as the diseases they promised to cure. People were afraid of night air, and bloodletting was still a common practice. But several founders of the newly organized Seventh-day Adventist Christian Church had a better idea. They believed God had already provided the best remedies in nature, and they turned their attention to prevention, suggesting that fresh air, sunshine, rest, exercise, nutritious food.
Okay. Testing lab, testing lab. Testing lab mic. 1, 2. Testing 1, 2. Testing lab mic, 1, 2. Testing lab mic, 1, 2. Testing lab mic. I don't hear anything. That should be coming through.
Food and clean water could help people stay healthier. They also proposed that a simple diet rich in nutritious foods would help build stamina and strength. Health reformers, led by James and Ellen White and other early Seventh-day Adventists, looked at the life of Jesus Christ and wanted to follow in his ways, caring for those who were hurting, physically, emotionally, and spiritually. With this mission in mind, these pioneers launched the Western Health Reform Institute in Battle Creek, Michigan, on September 5, 1866. They had limited staff, an 8-room house, and just one patient. They also had more faith than medical know-how, but they were determined to follow the Creator's footsteps. Pooling their resources, the church members managed to put several students through medical school. One was 23-year-old John Harvey Kellogg, who became medical director of the Institute in 1876 and changed its name to the Battle Creek Sanitarium. Dr. Kellogg was an avid reader who traveled the world to increase his medical knowledge and improve the work of the sanitarium. He was also a prolific inventor, developing procedures, surgical techniques, and medical equipment, much of which influenced the medical care we know today. In an effort to provide an easy and nourishing option to the typical unhealthy breakfast of that time, Kellogg ground corn and formed it into ready-to-eat flakes. His brother, who worked with him, later started the cereal company that still carries the family name today. Dr. Kellogg's expertise and innovations were widely known, and in the late 1800s through the early 1900s, the Battle Creek Sanitarium drew patients from around the world. Some of the most famous of these were John D. Rockefeller of Standard Oil, department store founder J.C. Penney, inventor Thomas Edison, African-American educator and author Booker T. Washington, and aviator Amelia Earhart. William Howard Taft, the 27th President of the United States, was the 100,000th patient of Dr. Kellogg and the Battle Creek Sanitarium. On a cold winter night in 1902, as Kellogg was out of town, the Battle Creek Sanitarium caught fire and burned to the ground. Undeterred by the disheartening news, Kellogg immediately boarded a train for Battle Creek. By the time he arrived, he had already sketched out plans for building a new and even grander sanitarium. This began an era of rapid development of like-minded institutions all over the country. Boulder Sanitarium in 1893, Hinsdale Sanitarium in 1905, and in that same year in Southern California, an abandoned hotel was purchased and Loma Linda Sanitarium was opened for care and medical education. Today, Loma Linda University Health ranks as one of the top-rated medical schools in the country. In 1908, Florida Sanitarium in Orlando was founded in faith by a small group of church members, including one person who mortgaged his own home for the down payment. Today, Adventist Health System employees, diverse in culture and backgrounds, find opportunities to provide highly advanced levels of care in a Christ-centered environment that encourages the health and healing of the whole person. Adventist Health System hospitals, outpatient centers, and nursing homes extend the healing ministry of Christ as far north as Wisconsin, as far west as Colorado, and as far south as Texas and Florida. Adventist Health System, reaching out, touching hearts, healing lives.
Fit Possible program. We travel out into schools in Orange, Osceola, and Seminole counties, and we bring a really fun and interactive health and wellness program that focuses on food, mood, move, and recharge. We come out to the schools once a month for a full semester, and the kids get to know us as secret agents. So I'm Agent Erica, and we go on missions together. We uncover clues, we play games, we give out prizes. The kids get their very own Fit secret agent badge, and it's a really fun and interactive way for kids to learn holistic health and wellness.
What I love about Mission Fit is that it's not just another class that the kids go and see. It's something that it helps them learn while they're having a lot of fun. And I can see that they bring to the house, because when we come the next days or the next lesson, they come and tell us how they teach their parents how to read a label, how they teach their parents how to look for fruits or vegetables in an apple pie and see if that's part of the ingredients. So it's very rewarding.
So every week when they come, the kids are excited because they don't know what they're going to do. And within the lesson, it starts off with something educational, maybe sitting and learning about fruits and vegetables, but real quickly it turns into a game. And then from there it goes into exercise, and there's movement. And then they might bring them back and recap what they've learned. And with that exercise and movement, it keeps them engaged the whole time. And actually, they line up and they leave, and even in their classrooms, they're still calm and engaged because of their routine.
That's gonna be good for our mood.
Well, this is the third year we've had the Mission Fit program here at Fern Creek, and it's an extraordinary program, really. A lot of our children live in what we would describe as a food desert. They don't have access in their neighborhood to a grocery store. Often it's just a convenience store where fresh fruits and vegetables aren't available to them. So we want our children to learn about fresh fruits and vegetables and how important they are in their diet.
So it's really exciting to see that what they're doing at school, and they're bringing it home and they're teaching it back to us. And they're asking to be active. They're asking to stay on the move. They're telling us about how sleep is important and understanding that we set their bedtime for a reason, because it helps recharge them for the next day.
we see with the rise of childhood obesity leading into adult obesity, great importance in teaching our children healthy food habits and good nutrition.
So the students benefit by developing healthy habits. The schools benefit by having more focused students, and the community benefits by having a culture of health and wellness.
Mission Fit Possible program. We travel out into schools in Orange, Osceola, and Seminole counties, and we bring a really fun and interactive health and wellness program that focuses on food, mood, move, and recharge. We come out to the schools once a month for a full semester, and the kids get to know us as secret agents. So I'm Agent Erica, and we go on missions together. We uncover clues, we play games, we give out prizes. The kids get their very own Fit Secret Agent badge, and it's a really fun and interactive way for kids to learn holistic health and wellness.
What I love about Mission Fit is that it's not just another class that the kids go and see. It's something that it helps them learn while they're having a lot of fun. And I can see that they bring to the house, because when we come the next days or the next lesson, they come and tell us how they teach their parents how to read a label, how they teach their parents how to look for fruits or vegetables in an apple pie and see if that's part of the ingredients. So it's very rewarding.
So every week when they come, the kids are excited because they don't know what they're going to do. And within the lesson, it starts off with something educational, maybe sitting and learning about fruits and vegetables, but real quickly it turns into a game. And then from there it goes into exercise, and there's movement. And then they might bring them back and recap what they've learned. And with that exercise and movement, it keeps them engaged the whole time. And actually, they line up and they leave, and even in their classrooms, they're still calm and engaged because of their routine.
Well, this is the third year we've had the Mission Fit program here at Fern Creek, and it's an extraordinary program, really. A lot of our children live in what we would describe as a food desert. They don't have access in their neighborhood to a grocery store. Often it's just a convenience store where fresh fruits and vegetables aren't available to them. So we want our children to learn about fresh fruits and vegetables and how important they are in their diet.
So it's really exciting to see that what they're doing at school, and they're bringing it home and they're teaching it back to us. And they're asking to be active. They're asking to stay on the move. They're telling us about how sleep is important, and understanding that we set their bedtime for a reason, because it helps recharge them for the next day.
We see with the rise of childhood obesity leading into adult obesity, great importance in teaching our children healthy food habits and good nutrition.
So the students benefit by developing healthy habits. The schools benefit by having more focused students, and the community benefits by having a culture of health and wellness.
Because guys wear ties, it makes it real simple.
I know.
I assume you want to walk around.
I do, yeah.
So let's see.
I do want to walk around. So how about we just
maybe
put this right here.
Is there a way to button the coat up so we can clip to the side of the coat or something? We want to try to get it somewhere in the middle here.
Well, we're going to tell you what we're going to try here. Let's do this, and then Should we just hook it? I know this moves.
Across America, from the mountain states to the Midwest, from the east and south, in sleepy towns and bustling cities, the work of Adventist Health System is defined by a unifying thread that winds through more than 150 years of a health and healing legacy. In the mid-1800s, health and long lives were rare. Good health care was practically non-existent, and doctors often prescribed odd elixirs and treatments, some of which were as harmful as the diseases they promised to cure. People were afraid of night air, and bloodletting was still a common practice. But several founders of the newly organized Seventh-day Adventist Christian Church had a better idea. They believed God had already provided the best remedies in nature, and they turned their attention to prevention, suggesting that fresh air, sunshine, rest, exercise, nutritious food, and clean water could help people stay healthier. They also proposed that a simple diet rich in nutritious foods would help build stamina and strength. Health reformers, led by James and Ellen White, and other early Seventh-day Adventists, looked at the life of Jesus Christ and wanted to follow in his ways, caring for those who were hurting physically.
So now you can actually see notes if you have notes on there. So,
oh, I don't.
But this should, these should work right here.
I just hope I remember.
There's no audio or anything, right? Okay.
No, not in this time.
Okay, it's kind of curved in a little bit. See if you can curve it out. How's it? Yeah, it's gonna be interesting. Yeah.
I don't know how that's gonna work. Would yeah. it be better yeah. putting it right here?
Maybe. Yeah. Yeah. It's gonna be tough. Maybe even straight. Let me see the thing real quick here.
All right.
I know you're tethered to it a little bit. So straight up like that, and try put it right in about the center there. Clip it though, so it.
Oh, it's not clipped.
Yeah,
oh,
clip it to the side. We're just trying to get it more center. It's tricky. Whenever I see a female, it's like, uh-oh, put one of those on.
Is
because
this going to work?
Because ties, that should. Let's see
I
how
move
it.
Move around a lot.
Let's see how it goes here.
I hope I don't ruin it for you.
Okay, so it should be, click the front, or wherever the main unit is, click the top of that, and
oh,
it will
okay.
be.
What am I supposed to do with it?
Can you bring the main unit out? Let me
yeah.
There, there it is. So let me do this. I'm gonna lock it here. Since you have it there, now it's on, and I'm gonna take it down from there. But do a test.
Oh,
see.
That's a all right. Testing 1, 2, 3. But I'll speak out like that.
Yes,
is that okay?
You do speak out. See,
it's
tricky.
It's gonna be tricky. So I will not speak down into the mic. Do you want me to put it on
right,
here?
Let me see. Curtis, can you come in real quick? Okay.
I think we should put it here. Maybe.
Where would you suggest you put that? Just like I thought. You've got.
Hi, I'm great.
Curtis,
how are you?
Very
good
nice
to meet
you.
should we do this? Do you think? Is that?
I kind of joke that when it's not a guy in a tie, it gets tricky.
It's fine.
Is that
where it
work?
Is here. Oh, excuse
okay.
me.
That's what we tried.
Yeah, I'm afraid, but I'm gonna speak out. I won't speak down. So. I can hold it. Would that help?
Way too much. So let's go there with it.
Okay.
And we can adjust on our end.
All right.
If you want to go ahead and put that on.
Got it.
Okay.
We're good.
That'll work. Okay. So just clip that on, and I will mute it and unmute it from the booth.
Okay.
So you can keep it on.
Sounds good to me. Hello.
Hey, Rod.
I'm Kathy. Nice to meet
Thanks
you.
Thanks for coming over.
Thanks. It's a pleasure to be here.
Did you enjoy the tour today?
Oh, it's fabulous. It's really fabulous.
Yeah, it's been fun to do it.
You have a really great team. And you're going to be great. Literally tomorrow morning. Wasn't home for Thanksgiving. And my son is bringing my baby tomorrow evening. So yeah, so I'm telling you, I'd do anything for that baby.
I buzzed with that baby. We good?
Yep.
Okay, great.
Okay, so that's lab one. Good.
Sure.
Testing one, two. Testing one, two.
Mm-hmm. You might also want to say, because this is a little bit old, unfortunately. No worry. I'm at the Brookings Institute as well, so you might want to say both. And
all right, 5 minutes. Okay, we gotta go ahead and get Curtis down to help out with the show. Everything
work?
It seems like it. Yeah, okay. It's not as great as we put on time. But we got it. We should pick up. And we'll adjust it as needed too.
And then the most important thing actually isn't here, so that I will tell you.
Sure.
I'm gonna mute it for you.
Oh, wow.
And I'm super proud of them.
Let me see the unit itself one more time. I want to make sure there's no battery to get you through.
Okay.
Rebar, should be good.
Okay. And I have a little granddaughter, and she is the love of my life. And none of the rest of the stuff really matters. Because the most important stuff is that I love being a mom.
That's awesome.
It's true.
We have a two-year-old, and he's just a bundle of joy.
That's what it's all about, you know? And that's what the hospital is all about. You know, it's giving life and allowing people to experience it. So that's what's most important. Yeah, so thank you.
So I'm going to ask you a question.
This is on, I trust?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, we're good.
A few more minutes. Yeah, more.
Where am I staying, Steve? Downtown. It's lovely. Oh my God, it's so lovely. And thank you for the tree.
Oh, you're welcome.
Oh my God, that was so sweet of you. Really, really nice.
It's different than most of the places.
Yeah. Oh, it's just great. I mean, it just is so lovely. Thank you, guys. That's fine. This is really what it's all about. I have so loved to be put in the lab for that. You know,
yeah,
they bring the science to people and allow them to really see what's going on. It's just a gift.
It's an important topic, too.
Mm-hmm. FLA is like really starting to happen. But, you know, it's been back on the agenda. Probably more so now. Oh, thank you so much. Well, I've been watching you really seeing what you did with the puppets here, meeting Emily the puppet, and it's pretty cool. Oh, it was really fun. I had a good time too, and I love that you have the child.
Yeah,
it's just amazing. Thank you.
Anybody in the touch is just.
I know. Well, if I had that lobby, I'm not sure I'd leave either. I mean, I came in and I was immediately like, whoa, this is a different kind of place. Very cool. So is it mostly you open this site to the public?
Yeah, so basically
very cool.
Could be parents, could be organizational. You get a wife.
And I was going to say, how many people do you usually get? Is this about what you were looking for? Yeah.
Well, give or take, we were, I think, Thanksgiving week was kind of rough for people.
Yeah, sorry about that.
Whoa.
Thank you.
Want to go and get started?
Okay. You're on.
All right. I'm gonna kick you off here and then shut this mic down and just turn hers on. Yeah, we're ready to go. Yeah. You're my client.
Oh, you're so sweet. Hirsh, H-I-R-S-H, Pasek. So it's Hirsh.
Welcome, everybody.
Thanks. No worry. No worry.
You're in for a treat tonight. We have our hosting Dr. Hirsh-Pasek here, on who will be speaking on developmental children and adolescents. We have Dr. Wadahalwin, who's going to be introducing her as well. He's the chief medical officer for the Florida Hospital Children's Walt Disney's Pavilion here. And I'll go ahead and let him take the stage.
Thank you, Steve. It's a great honor and pleasure to have Dr. Hirsh-Pasek here. I just had an opportunity to chat a little bit with her before her talk, and I'm really excited about what we're going to hear tonight. Dr. Hirsh-Pasek is the Stanley and Deborah Lefkowitz Distinguished Faculty Fellow in the Department of Psychology at Temple University, and she serves as the Director of Temple Infant and Child Laboratory there. In addition to that, she is also a Senior Fellow at the Brookings Institution. She received a bachelor's degree from the University of Pittsburgh and a PhD at the University of Pennsylvania. Her research in the areas of early language development, literacy, and infant cognition has been funded by a variety of organizations, including the National Science Foundation, National Institute of Health and Human Development, and the Department of Education. And she has a pretty impressive resume with over 11 books and more than 150 publications. One of her books, Einstein Never Used Flashcards, How Our Children Really Learn and Why They Need to Play More and Memorize Less, won the prestigious Books for Better Life Award as the best psychology book in 2003. It is the title that's cool as well, but I'm sure the book is very interesting too. She has won numerous awards, including the APA Bronfenbrenner Award for Lifetime Contribution to the Science of Developmental Psychology, and the APA Award for Distinguished Service to the Psychological Science. And I was talking to her, I quickly learned that the real joy and love of her life are her children, which are three. She has three sons and a granddaughter, and she was telling me about them and telling me how, I'm sorry about this, how much joy they bring to her, and that's the motivation of all the work that she has done. So I'm really excited to hear her talk about becoming brilliant and reimagining education for our times. Dr. Hirsh-Pasek.
Well, hello, everybody. And thank you so much for letting me come to Florida when it got cold in Pennsylvania. I really, really appreciate that. It is really great to be here today. Ooh, I didn't realize the scarf was going to hit the microphone. I'll take it off if it becomes a problem. But at any rate, it's really great to be here. And I realized when I first walked into the Florida Hospital that this was a really different kind of place. It's a really different kind of place, not only because I went into the lobby and I thought I was at Disney World, okay? So then I was thinking, this is at least the coolest hospital I have ever been in my life. But secondly, I was meeting these incredible people that you have working for you. And when I met you guys, I immediately gave you a hug, which is like kind of what I do. And you said to me, remind me, Samantha, right?
It's Chantel.
Okay. Sorry, Chantel. Said to me, oh my God, you could be hired as a child life person. And I thought, that is so cool. So thank you, because that's really what makes it when you work with kids. So today I wanted to tell you a little bit about play. And I want to tell you why it's like really important and why what you're doing at the hospital and using a lot of play to help kids is actually critical. But I'm going to nest it in something a little bit bigger. And the bigger is that play actually might be how you get brilliant. And I know that sounds like a stretch, but stick with me for just a while. Let's go to the first slide. Now here, all I want you to do is to follow what I do. Easy enough?
Yes.
Okay, here we go. You're really good. Okay, now the question I have for you is, what did you hear? What did you hear? Give me any answer.
Clapping.
Clapping, okay? That is the number one answer that we usually hear
Okay. But I actually heard something. Yeah, yeah. What did you say? Rhythm. Oh, wait a minute. Because the minute you tell me rhythm, actually you didn't really hear clapping. What you heard was mathematics. Okay? Oh, my gosh. Because in order to do clapping and to do rhythm, you have to cut time, right? And you have to do it in a regular way. Oh, that's pretty cool. But wait. You couldn't have done that if you hadn't paid close attention to what I did. So it means you were having a social relationship with me when you were following my clapping, which means you have collaboration going on with the mathematics. This is getting very powerful. It's not looking just like clapping anymore. Well, let's try another one. What is going on here? Anyone, come on, scream it out. Pretend play, acting. Anyone have something else? Imagination, what else?
My 6-year-old.
Your 6-year-old is doing this. All right, I'm going to suggest to you that we could put another lens on that. In order to be King Arthur, you have to have narrative, storyline. That narrative storyline happens to be the precursor to literacy. It happens to be strong communication skills. I mean, how else are you going to learn a word like cruntilations? Right? You can look that one up later. All right. So you have collaboration. How about perspective taking? You have to kind of know what King Arthur's going to do in this particular case. Whoa. That just acting is looking like a whole lot deeper than just acting. It's like a history lesson. It's like a social lesson. It's like a literacy lesson. Oh my gosh, can we keep going on like this? Just one more. I mean, many of you have this on your refrigerator, do you not? Here we have Marley, a 24-month-old, made this artistic creation. Isn't it beautiful? Okay. And over here, this smush was done by Dahani of 34 months. Okay? What do you see? Now, usually when our kids bring home something like this, we look at it. We have to be nice, right? So we put it on the refrigerator door. And the question is, what are we really seeing? And the answer is mush. I mean, really, right? But now I want you to take another look at Marley. Because it turned out that for Marley to be able to do these circles, she had to keep her hand down on the piece of paper and apply a certain amount of pressure for an extended period of time, and she had to intend to do that, or she couldn't have done it. I want you to look over here, not only at the hand control, but look at the spatial sense. Do you see this? Like, you could be in an art gallery, and I could be saying it much more formally, with my pretend offending British accent. And I could say, as you see here, the Marley painting shows us what it means to use the entire space with spatial intent. Marley obviously made a choice here to space out the purples, where you could have done it one on top of the other. Who said you had to put it in spatial contrast? But Marley knew. And from now on, when you hang those things on your refrigerator door, you too are going to appreciate that there's more here than meets the eye. Well, you see, we can change the lens. One way we think about learning in and out of school is to reframe the way we talk about learning in education. And that's what I want to do with you today. For practitioners, for policymakers, I want us to think about playful, active learning as educational. So bear with me as I tell you a little bit of history as to why I went in this direction. It turns out that we are entering a new era. And that new era has been called the knowledge era. We're leaving the information age, where just learning factoids was enough, Today we can get those factoids quickly. In fact, in seconds, by just going on Wiki and going in Google. So factoids are no longer enough. We have to integrate the information that we get on Wiki and Google if we're going to be successful leaders of the future. Now, Daniel Pink wrote a beautiful book in 1995. And I want us to read a little bit together. You got to read Daniel Pink's book, right? Isn't it like amazing? It's called The Whole New Mind. But stay with me. The past few decades have belonged to a certain kind of person with a certain kind of mind. Computer programmers who could crank code, lawyers who could craft contracts, MBAs who could crunch numbers. The next line we must all say together, but we have to say it with conviction because it doesn't work if you don't say it with conviction. Are you ready? But the keys to the kingdom are changing hands. One more time because it's so beautiful. The keys to the kingdom are changing hands. And look what he says next. The future belongs to a very different kind of person. The future belongs to creators and empathizers, to pattern recognizers and meaning makers, to the artists because they're better integrators. In the city of Philadelphia, we have a hospital called the Thomas Jefferson Hospital. It's quite a renowned hospital in Philadelphia. They just changed their admissions practice to medical school. Ready for the shock, guys? Yeah, you have to do well in organic chemistry. But they're looking for artists. I said, excuse me? They said, sure. You can look stuff up on Google. We have WebMD. People are getting their diagnoses over a digital framework. But if you want somebody really great, they have to be pattern recognizers. They have to be the ones who can put it all together and say, you know what? I'm seeing something that Google couldn't tell you. I'm seeing something that the robot couldn't detect. And that's what's going to make for the best kind of a doctor. The integrators, the pattern makers, the meaning makers. In the definitive Drucker, Liz Edersheim says the same thing. She says, you know, life is changing out there, saith Peter Drucker, the father of modern management and modern business. He says, we live in a Lego world. And he defines the Lego world as a world where we're constantly taking pieces of knowledge and reassembling them in different ways. Who knew that Legos would be the model for modern business? But she puts it this way in a beautiful example. So now I have to go to your famous basketball team, which, yes, is way better than the Philadelphia 76ers. So if you're ever feeling bad, just look up north, okay? But here's the game. It says, if you're a coach of a basketball team, how do you get a great basketball, a great game? You have to coach it by watching the position of the different players on your team. And if you find out that the offense on the other side is hitting you hard and what you're doing isn't working, you better put in somebody who does a better free throw. Correct? You better put in somebody who can get the 3 points. You have to constantly be rearranging that team on the field in order to meet the demands of what they're doing in the offense and defense on the other side. Does that make sense to you? Now let's translate that to your children. What we have to train our children to be are the coaches who now know how to put the right pieces on the field at the right time. What we don't need to do is to train them to be the memorizers in an era where Google and Wiki can do it for them. So there's a lot of people talking about it. The Partnership for 21st Century Skills is talking about it. The Learning Metric Task Force is talking about it. Everybody's talking about what are the new skills? What are the new skills? What do we really need to do to be successful? And we can ask ourselves whether the way we have been doing business is really preparing our children for the future in which they're going to live. And I'm going to suggest to you right now that it might not be. That the answer to that question is no. We need a rethink. A rethink as big as what you have been doing in this hospital. A rethink that's going to put a suite of skills out there. And I'm going to show you what they are, and you're going to see that they're actually being used right here today. And it's how we have to raise our kids. Let's go to the two kinds of success. The traditional way of thinking about success is, how do I raise my kids so they're going to do really well in the test? I mean, let's face it, okay? How am I going to raise my kids so they're going to be really good in reading, be really good in math, and they're not going to embarrass me, and when they get to the front door of formal schooling, I can be assured that they're going to look really good. Am I right? And I'm going to show you that even as babies, we are buying so-called educational toys and using so-called educational apps. Notice, I have to say so-called. Let me put quotations around them, okay? So that we're preparing them so that they're ready for the future. But I'm going to suggest, and I bet I'm right about this, because I think the hospital is going to be really excited with this definition, that there's another kind of success. And the 21st century way of thinking about success is going to be supporting children to be happy, to be healthy, to be thinking, to be caring, to be social, so that they become collaborative, creative, competent, and responsible citizens of the world tomorrow. How many of you want that for your kids? Notice the thinking part is there, right? We didn't dump the thinking part, but we added so much more. It's about creating a whole human being. This came actually from the definition that Canada is now using in the way they're transforming their education system. They're saying we need so much more if we're going to have successful Canadians. Just yesterday, in the New York Times, there was a beautiful piece that you should all look at by Mark Lippe. It was in the op-ed section. Actually, it was the front page of the op-ed section. And they were struggling with the question of, what do we do in America at a time when there is such divisiveness? How do we help move forward? And the argument that Lippe makes is that what we need to do is not be bickering back and forth at each other, but to learn to be whole people, not just identified as Democrat, Republican, or whatever else, but whole people who learn to be good citizens in America. That's a pretty powerful statement. And I'd like to suggest to you that our children don't know from this hate. They don't know from being Democrat or know from being Republican. They just know to play with other kids. And we can help them, through play, learn to succeed and be whole kids who are social, caring, happy, healthy, thinking kids who are going to grow up to be competent and collaborative citizens. Think about that. And then the question is, well, has the old traditional way worked for us? I mean, why would we leave it? And I'd like to suggest to you it hasn't. We have a lot of kids who are stressed out. We have a lot of parents who are stressed out because their kids are stressed out. We have a lot of parents who are stressing out their kids. We could keep going this way. We have a society that is stressing out the parents to stress out the kids, okay? It's not working for us. We have kids who are crying because they have to take statewide tests. And they have to take statewide tests, and then they have to take statewide tests. In fact, I couldn't believe it the first time I ever heard of it, is that preschoolers in Florida were taking the FCAT pledge. Had you ever heard of it? Seriously? Oh, you got to hear about the FCAT pledge. This one blew me away. Apparently, there were whole streams of kids. They would put their hand on their heart the day before they had to take the test, and they promised they would have a good breakfast the morning before they took the test. I swear to you, I mean, I wrote it down, and I actually keep it in my office because it's so something we don't want to do. Okay, and the FCAT puts it, and I will do a good job on the test. And I will practice really hard so that I do a good job on the test. I can give you, there's like 10 principles. You look it up, the FCAT pledge. Where has this led us? It's led us to a place where the military now says that we have a national security risk because of the way we have educated our children. Well, you might say, well, maybe it's worked for us. I mean, at least in the tests they ought to do great. But it turns out that one of my colleagues, Pasi Salberg, who is the person who is largely credited with helping the Finnish system get to number one, he says, this is what you got for the countries. This is where they're panning out. If you want to see how well they're doing on the test, are you looking real hard for the United States? Look real hard. What you might notice is that they're not up here with Finland and Canada, okay? They're stuck in the middle again, okay? Can you see them there? So obviously our stressing out the parents and stressing out the kids hasn't really worked, even in generating good outcomes on the test. So what we're doing in Becoming Brilliant is trying to reorganize the way we think about education in and out of school so that these kind of caring, compassionate, happy, healthy, whole kids are the product that we want from our society, and asking how to groom them. And we're suggesting that the way it starts is here, by learning how to get along with people. That's the base. It turns out, by the way, that human beings are what my collaborator Mike Tomasello calls the ultra-social species. Ultra-social. We rely on one another. We rely on the kind of caring and compassion and control of our impulses that only we as human beings have. And today, I saw that. I saw that in your hospital. I saw that when I saw that little girl, Glenda. Yeah, I'm going to get it right. I'm trying. Gabby. Only met her for 2 minutes. Emily? Yeah, okay.
Very good.
All right. And Emily the puppet. And the caring staff here went and asked not just how she was, but how Emily was. And whether Emily felt good. And you could see a child smile. And that smile meant, I'm being cared for. Somebody cares about me. Somebody cares about my best friend, the puppet. It starts on a social base with human beings caring for one another and creating community. When I walked through the halls of this hospital, I saw that community. When I walked through the halls here, I saw people greet one another. I saw people holding hands, high-fiving that they were going to solve problems together. Even for our youngest citizens, some of them only 27, right, born at 27 weeks of age. That's caring. That's collaboration. That's number one. And built on that collaboration is communication. Because we can't have a conversation with one another if we don't have each other to have the conversation with. Does that make sense? Communication. Content. What we've been spending our time with in the traditional view is built on communication and collaboration. So some people call that communication and collaboration the soft skills. Well, guess what? They're not soft at all. Because you can't learn to read if you don't have language, and you can't learn language if you don't have somebody to speak with. Does that make sense to everybody? So reading is a soft skill, if communication and collaboration are soft skills. I hate to use a soft skill. It's out of my vocabulary, okay? Let's move on to critical thinking. Critical thinking happens after you have content. And then creative innovation happens on top of critical thinking. You have to know enough to be creative. And confidence. The confidence of letting our kids try, of letting our community try, and even sometimes make mistakes along the way. Because that's where we learn grit. That's where we learn persistence. And now, where do we get it? Play. We get it through play. Not just when our kids play, but when we play. When we built a community where we feel safe enough to make a mistake and to play. Now, play and playful learning has kind of gone out of style. People are afraid to use that four-letter word, oh my God. But I'd like to suggest to you that that discovery-based playful learning is how we're really going to move forward in our understanding of the world. That's what real education is. So what I want to do for the rest of my time with you is this. I want to talk about the current state of play in early education. I then want to suggest to you that we can define something that I'm going to call playful learning. I'm going to put them together and tell you that they should never, ever be separated again. And then I'm going to prove it to you. I'm going to show you playful learning in social skills and playful learning in academic skills. I'm then going to move on and give you an integrative model of a way to think about it using the very same six C's that I presented before. And then I'm going to put it on you. What's your role? What's your role as parents? What's your role as policymakers? What's your role as practitioners that deal with families? How can we use the six C's as a kind of grid so that we go beyond just the growth charts that we use in our offices to really helping build whole kids who can be successful, responsible citizens of the future? So the current state of play. It ain't good. In 1981, a young child had a full 40% of his or her discretionary time available for play. That then dropped precipitously. By 1997, it had shrunk to 25%, and it is way lower today. There was one report that came out of the Alliance for Childhood. It was a survey of New York, of schools in New York and in Los Angeles, and they asked, what's happening to open-ended play? When they looked at this, they tested 112 LA classrooms and 142 New York classrooms. We got to do this together because you will not believe it. Ready? 25% of the teachers in the LA sample reported having zero, no time whatsoever for play in their classrooms. None. That's huge. Well, let me remind you, these kids were five. Okay? Kindergarten classrooms. 61% of the New York sample reported having 30 minutes or less time for choice. That is, the kids didn't even get to choose whether they wanted to be with the blocks or they wanted to be with the books. I know it's sick out there. 79% of the New York teachers and 82% of the LA teachers told us what they're doing, given that they don't have play. Let me remind you, these are five-year-olds. I have to keep saying that because you wouldn't believe it otherwise. Ready? They're test prep. They're doing test prep for 20 minutes a day. There are several new books that speak to the same issue. One came out by Erica Christakis just this year. It's called The Importance of Being Little. Christakis asks us to rethink what the heck we are doing. Even our art projects have become pre-form. She says, people are like, the teachers have been turned into, I love this term, carnival barkers. Carnival barkers. And what are they doing now in these classrooms? They have a cutout turkey and a cutout apple, and they're supposed to glue the apple to the turkey. Doesn't look like the smush that I showed you earlier. Are we really happy when they bring home the cutout turkey and the cutout apple? I don't think so. Ph.D, 2016, says that 80% of the kindergarten children, of kindergarten teachers, now believe their children should be reading, up 50% from 1998. And you might ask, what's happening to the arts in our schools? Down by 16%. 16% in the last decade. Testing, up 29%. So what are we buying? This is what's happening in the society. Now, I usually look for my worst examples. These two definitely fit the bill. What you see on the left is a porta potty, but lest you should ever waste a moment with the porta potty and you wanted to have learning activities, you can put your iPad right in the front And there are special apps you can buy
that your children can watch while they're learning to go. But the new worst choice is this one here on the right. Any of you seen Baby Pod? What is that? Does anyone want to guess? It is a tampon-like device with a speaker in it so that you too can digitally deliver singing, music, book reading, whatever you like to your unborn child. Ready? Are you ready, guys? This is an OMG. Thank you. All right. With all this stuff, what we're doing is we're wearing out our youngest children, right? We're testing for factoids in our assessments rather than real learning. And it brought us to a point where the American Academy of Pediatrics issued a warning in 2012. They actually issued an earlier warning in 2006. And on my computer at home, I actually have the next one that's coming out your way in the next couple of months. This is what our physicians had to tell us. Play is essential to the social, emotional, cognitive, and physical well-being of children, beginning in early childhood. It is a natural tool for children to develop resiliency as they learn to cooperate and overcome challenges. Seriously? We needed the American Academy of Pediatrics to issue this warning so that we knew that play was important. It's another one. Ready with me? O-M-G. Okay, so I think we need to find a balance. We need to find the balance between our desire to enrich our kids' learning. Look, we all want our kids to succeed. I, for one, want all kids to succeed and to reach their highest potential. But gosh, we need some balance here. And the balance is between that and play, and I think we can use play because play helps us learn collaboration, communication, content, critical thinking, creative innovation, and the confidence to learn from failure. So how do I define playful learning? See if you see yourself in this grid. Okay? Playful learning. Well, playful learning includes both free play and guided play. And now I want you to think of it this way. On the one hand, we can have play that is initiated by an adult or a child, and we can have something that is directed by an adult or a child. So when a child initiates what he or she wants to do, build a fort, okay, and the child then goes about building the fort, we have free play. Everybody with me on that? Got it? Now what I want you to think of is the child initiates something that he or she wants to do, and what happens is the adult comes in and goes, oh my God, you're building a fort, let me put the roof on. Okay? We could call that co-opted play. Okay? Now we also have the case where we as adults like to take over totally because we want our children to learn all the time, so we initiate it, and we tell our kid what to do, and we could call that direct instruction, or if we make it a whole lot of fun, we could call it what Hapgood called chocolate-covered broccoli. You think it looks like play, but really, honest to God, underneath that chocolate, right, it's still broccoli. All right, I want to give you one new category. And that's the category where we help set up an environment, like in a children's museum, okay? Or we help set up an environment like in a Montessori school or a Reggio school. But in that environment, who takes control? The child, okay? And the child then directs what's going to happen. And we act not as directors, but as coaches in that world to help supplement what's going on rather than co-opting what's going on. Is everyone there? Okay? And that's what I'm going to call guided play. So guided play can either happen when there is a planned environment or where I kind of say, well, what else do you think could happen in this story? Where do you think
curious George is going to go next. I don't quite tell them, but I lead them in a way that allows them to explore the possibilities. On the one hand, we could call this, and I love this new term that I'm playing with, really stole it from a friend of mine who's in cancer research, constrained tinkering. Isn't it beautiful? Constrained tinkering. All right. We don't want our researchers to just go so crazy wild that they're not using what they know. But within a constrained world, constrained tinkering might be the way to go. All right, so you say to me, so is it really the case that guided play could really help our kids learn? And I'd like to suggest, yes, it is, and this is a tale of two Spocks. Okay? On the one hand, Dr. Spock knew it all the time. On the other hand, Mr. Spock did not get it at all. It turns out the collaboration is really important. It's important for impulse control. Some people call that the executive function, okay? Social regulation. It's when your kid doesn't kick the other kid off the swing, but actually says, oh, I can wait 2 minutes until you're done on the swing, and then it'll be my turn. I don't know any kids like that, but just that. All right, self-guidance, planning, self-reliance, socially responsible behavior. And measures of this kind of social impulse control and regulation predict out to a whole lot of stuff. To your kid's grit is actually predicted by their ability to regulate their own behavior. Your kid's taskmaster, their moral behavior, their sharing, their helpfulness is all predicted by how well they do in social regulation. So the question is, can you actually teach this? Does it actually work? How many of you know the marshmallow test? Some of you, but not all of you. Okay, it's beautiful. You got to Google marshmallow test because you got to watch this. All right, here's the story. All right, it comes from Columbia University. Beautiful, beautiful work that Michelle did in 1989. I put out two marshmallows. And you say to the child, oh, look, I have two marshmallows here. Oh, gosh, I got to go get something from the other room. So if you can just wait, when I get back, you can eat both marshmallows. But if you can't, I understand. Tap the bell, and then you get to eat one of the marshmallows. Got the task? All right. Now the kid has to wait. We call it delay of gratification. All right? You got to see these kids. The kids who can do it, they're like, I mean, seriously, you got to watch these videos. They're delicious. But there's something interesting that happened, all right? It turns out that when Michelle did this study, his kid was little. It's what we all do as developmental psychologists. We study something when our kids are little. Then, of course, our kids grow up, all right? So he's around college time, and he says to his son, hey, you know, all your friends, they took the marshmallow task. Let's figure out whether there's any relationship to how well they did in the marshmallow task and what they're like so many years later when they take their SAT. So he does the task, and by God, the kids who could, but wait, got 200 points better on their SATs on average. That's unbelievable. As it turns out, that people have seized on that, and my friends Elena Bedrova and Deb Leong have a program that's out in the schools now called Tools of the Mind, and it's really, really cool. So you get the ear, and I get the mouth. That means I get to talk, and you gotta listen. I promise that'll be reversed after this is over. But, okay, if you can do that, and you learn how to share, and you learn how to do things together, and I use this through the school day, guess what? Your kids can become better at emotion regulation. And guess what else? They do better on their reading and math outcomes. Absolutely incredible. And now, Megan McClellan, another colleague of mine who is in California, has invented a series of games like the clapping game that I did with you earlier, but now I'm going to change it just a little bit so you can see it for yourself. What I want you to do is clap once when I clap once and clap twice when I clap twice. Easy? Ready? See how you do. Beautiful. Now what I want you to do is clap twice when I clap once and clap once when I clap twice. You knew it was coming. Ready? Hard, right? Is it harder? What you just saw was emotion regulation. What McClellan has found is that we can actually teach our kids this. If we play games like this at home, they do better, and guess what? They have more grit, and they have better outcomes in all those tests that you care about. Well, that's sort of interesting. I mean, surprising. Collaboration, then, is a foundational skill for all the other skills that we really wanted our kids to have anyway. So why are we testing and testing 29% of the time when we could be playing clapping games and getting our kids to the same level? But you say, okay, Kath, you have convinced me that this might work in the social arena, but you're going to be hard-pressed to show me that it's actually going to breed cognitive academic skills. I can see it in your face. You're ready to challenge me on this. Aha! But I will show you that those games make a difference, too. Turns out, telling stories to your kids. Do you know we don't tell stories to our kids anymore? And, like, we sure could, because when our kids hear stories, they're learning narrative skills. Oh, amazing. I mean, not saying that you should gossip or anything, but we tell stories all the time to our friends. I saw her in the supermarket. Did you know she dyed her hair purple? I cannot believe it. All right, we have a main character. We have a setting, okay? Just think about what you can abstract from these moments. I do not urge you to gossip. Do something else. All right, let's try another one. Ba, 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 baren. Come on. Ba, 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 baren. Everyone. Ba, 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 baren. All right, we're going to stop. You just did phonics. Yeah? You just did phonics. All right, just imagine what we can do here. And there's research to suggest that. Here's another one. We just did games, all right? Well, we were trying to teach 5-year-olds and 6-year-olds vocabulary words. We did games. We put it in a chutes and ladders game, and we had all these wonderful things for King Arthur about the horse's nostrils. And what else did we have? Getting to a finish line and the scales of the dragon that were coming after you that you had to get. And when we did stuff like that and we compared it to the kids who just learned it in a really fun way by our going over definitions like you normally do in a preschool class, but I promise we made it really, 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 really fun. This was what happened. This is the game, and this is the non-game, even when we tried to make it really, really fun. Huh. Okay, but everybody's into STEM right now. You told me that it'll work for literacy, but STEM, I mean, is it really going to make a difference? Well, yeah. I mean, let's just take blocks as one example. Like, there was a day. It turned out Mayor Bloomberg had decided that we should take the blocks out of the preschool classrooms in New York. These are the kind of emergency calls I get. In hospitals, you get real emergencies. Okay. I get, oh, my gosh, they're taking the blocks out of the schools. Please help. And this prompted us to do a study. So the study was, well, like, what do kids learn when they're playing with blocks? Well, it turns out there's something really special about blocks, because when we're playing with blocks, you could imagine that you would use spatial terms like above, through, around, in, out. Is it true? Is that really what happens? So we designed a study. And here's our study. What you have over here is phase one, where we got some mega blocks, where we either gave them a pre-assembled bit of blocks, and we said play with it any way that you want. Or over here, we had a free play. Oh, you can put anything together that you want to put together. Go for it. Or over here, we created like IKEA furniture, okay? And you got to make a heliport or a garage. And we want to see what happened. And then in phase two, it was all IKEA furniture. Thank you, Mega Blocks. All right, that's our moment of thanks. So we said, did the play context make any difference in the way you naturally, you don't even know you're doing it, in the way you naturally talk? And the answer was, yep, in guided play, you got 10% more use of these spatial terms than you did in the non-guided play. And what I want to show you is, look here in the first light gray bars. This is the guided play. See how it's way up here? This is in free play, pre-assembled play. Oh, my gosh. And it ups it from what you would naturally do in just having conversations with your kids from 3% to 6% of your talk. So does it make a difference? Well, yeah, it actually that knowing spatial language, believe it or not, predicts how well you're going to do in math readiness. Really? Yeah, turns out spatial skills are basic STEM skills that predict out to mathematics. In fact, we did another thing where we asked kids to simply copy these 2D designs or these 3D designs. The kids were 3 years to 5 years of age. And we noticed something really amazing. The 3-year-old kids who could copy our designs, we take the 3-year-old kids and we take their score on our little, what we call the TOSA, the test of spatial ability, and then we put in that social regulation score, which we can also measure. Are you ready for this? We can account for 78% of what you're going to look like at the beginning of school in your math scores. Oh my gosh, by playing with blocks, turns out to be important for your later math skills. Finally, I just wanted to give you one more where we looked at a kind of guided play, free play, where we gave them a funky toy. Well, we didn't really do this, but a friend, Liz Bonowitz, and Lucas, and Gwen Goodman, Spelke, and Schultz have all used this funky toy. Now, it turns out this toy has several different functions it can do. If you look in one place and you press something, you get a light. If you turn something else, a bell rings, okay? If you move something else, you get like a shaky sound. It's a really cool toy, and it's sort of like kids playing with a gadget. Now, on one condition, what I do is I show you that if I twist here, the bell will sound. And with the other condition, I say, hey, kids, play with it any way that you want to. Then I let them play. And the kids who were taught that if you turn here, you get a bell sound, guess what they did for the whole play period? Turn here and get a bell sound. And guess what the other kids did when they had more freedom? They discovered all the features of all the properties of the toy. So if we stop constraining them too much, but we give them enough space in which to explore with cleverly designed toys and cleverly designed environments, our children will learn. Now let's look at what they're learning. What they're learning, I'd like to suggest, are precisely the 6 skills that I told you about before. And let's watch them build. In collaboration, our young children are surely going to start by trying to do things on their own. This is a model that you're about to see unfold that is built off thousands of papers in the scientific literature. Kids move from that on my own phase to a kind of what you call parallel play. I sit here, and you sit here, and I kind of don't really care what you're doing, but I kind of will look over every so often just to make sure I don't care, okay? Parallel play. By the way, I want you to think about this in your offices, in your hospital as well, because it's exactly the same. You know those people who like to work on their own? You know? And how about the one who are in the cubby next door to you, and they kind of care, and they kind of don't? And then they move up, and they learn how to do a back and forth. Back and forth is sort of, well, I'll write the draft, and then I'll send it to you. And then when you're done with your edits, could you send it back to me? All right? Back and forth. Notice how much more powerful it would be if we sat down and we dreamed it together. Right? If we had 2 kids, and they decided together how they were going to build using that train set. Can you see that difference? Build it together. And built on that is communication skills. Communication skills aren't just about raw emotion. Don't we tell our kids that all the time? Stop screaming and use your words. Use your words. Okay? And then we move to a show and tell. Sorry. That I want to show you, I'm going to tell you what I have. Okay? And we do this even in our school format, show and tell. By the way, I know a lot of people in the business world who are show and tell people. You know them? They're very anxious to tell you what they're doing, but they rarely ask what you're doing. Facebook is one of those ventures that is a show and tell kind of place, okay? As if everybody cares, really, what restaurant you went to last night. I'm going to break it to you. No, they don't, okay? Having a dialogue and then telling a joint story. Content is built on top of the communication and the collaboration. Critical thinking is built on the content. Critical thinking, learning that it's not just about seeing is believing. This is one of the problems I think we all had with the new fake news that came out. Nobody questioned it. Nobody questioned it, including Facebook, that allowed this to go on. Wherever we stood, there was no grounding anymore. There were no gatekeepers anymore. And so we were all reduced to a seeing is believing kind of society. We can appreciate that truth's different. Your truth may be different than my truth is. But we have to move up to understanding that most of what we have are opinions. And at the end of the day, well, in politics, we may let it get away with opinions. None of us would permit that when we walk into this hospital. None of us would permit it when we're going to have a brain tumor and we're going to have a surgery. What do we want? What I want is the evidence. I want my doctor to weigh the evidence and, based on the evidence, to tell me what they think is the best course forward. Fair? And I think we should demand that at all levels as we become citizens. Creative innovation. How do we learn to go beyond mere experimenting of dumping paint on a canvas and moving up so that we solve problems, develop a voice, and actually have a vision? You know these people. Your hospital here has a vision, and it is a beautiful vision about how a community can care for one another and how caring is the base upon which everything else is built. And confidence builds on that. Let's take this model. Let's take this model for just a moment and understand that we revisit it with each thing that we learn. That it's not just a linear model, it's a spiral that we revisit time and time again. It's living. It's a dynamic model of learning that goes from 0 to 99, that is in the context of our schools, but out of our schools too, where children spend 80% of their waking time. Each of these skills that I've talked to you about are malleable, that is, they can be changed with our children and with ourselves. And they are measurable, some better and some worse. And over time, we can help our children get better in each of these skills so that they can meet the kind of success that we'd like them to have and all the potential that we'd like them to have in the world. So where do we stand? Where do you stand? Where do we want our children to stand? Where do our children stand as collaborators, as communicators, in content, which also includes learning to learn skills, in their critical thinking skills, in their creative innovation? And how do we set up our environments to help them learn in each of these areas? Example, when I teach my college classroom, I teach them through the six C's. In college, not just for little kids, but in college. And I ask myself as I set up that class, what am I doing to force them to collaborate? So we have discussion posts, and they have to work with three other members in the class in order to present that. It's built into the classroom. What are you doing in your homes? What are we doing in this hospital to help build collaboration as part of what goes on? What are we doing to build those communication skills? I have them do essay tests, and I have them do multiple guest tests. I have them learn to give oral presentations. And they have to be good listeners who can critically evaluate what's going on when another person gives a presentation. And they're required to do all that to build their communication skills. What are we doing in our own homes to help our children do that? Do we have family dinners where we discuss issues of the day? Do we have family dinners where our kids get a chance to speak? In my house, we used to have what we called the family meeting. And in the family meeting, everyone else had to sit back and not blab while the person who thought they were wronged, for whatever reason, and it could be stupid, like they didn't get a hot dog that night, made their case, okay? Made their case. Let me give you one example from my home. We used to have this thing called make your best argument because I was perpetually late at getting home, and then I knew I needed dinner, and I never seemed to be there in time to really make anything that was truly healthy. I really regret that I did that. But anyway, so several times a week we had to go out to eat. And the way we chose where we were going was we did make your best argument, okay? Make your best argument always started with my little guy. I have three sons. And my little guy would always say, pizza. Okay, why should we have pizza? Pizza has all the food groups. Okay, Mikey, give it to me. And he would, like, you know, outline the whole argument, and then the other two would come in and give their argument. In fourth grade, Mikey comes home and he says to me, Mom, you will not believe what happened today. And I said, sounds like it was a great day. He goes, it was. And I said, well, what happened? And he said, we learned about the five-paragraph essay. I said, oh, that's very exciting. Like, really? And he goes, everyone else was confused, but I knew it was all about pizza and just make your best argument, okay? So what are we doing in our homes that allows us to make our best argument? So the question then comes down to this. How do we put it in the community that we live in? How do we put it in the hospital? And what ought we do as practitioners, as parents, as doctors, as physicians who are working with young children? What do we ask? How do we use the grid to help us? Well, I wanted to show you a little bit about what we're doing out in the community, and then I'm going to put it back on you. In the community, I'm asking the question of what are we doing with the 80% of the waking time that our young children are not in school? What are we doing with it? And a lot of our kids right now are spending a lot of that time doing what? Technology. Technology. In fact, do you know that in the eights and overs right now, I mean, this is stunning, so get ready. They're spending 13 hours a day doing tech. All right, just put it out there. Times seven, that's more than a full-time job. That's more than a full-time job that they are spending in front of digital devices. Okay, but you think, whew, at least my kid's not eight yet. Well, don't be so happy, okay? Turns out that under one, 65% of kids now own a device. 65% of kids now own their own device. That's like scary, okay? And they're on it a lot, all right? So we have to watch ourselves. And we have to watch ourselves as parents. What are we doing? Because when we're constantly looking at that computer instead of in their eyes, guess what? Collaboration is violated, and they know it. All right? There was a study that was done in a fast food restaurant. Out of 67 parents who were in the fast food restaurant. You know the study? Yeah? How many people do you think were looking at their own cell phones instead of at their kids? Close, 80-some, I think it's 85 or something. 55, you can figure out, 55 out of 67. Isn't that scary? Okay, that's like incredible. This is one of the things we're doing. It's called Urban Thinkscape. And in Urban Thinkscape, we're going to normal everyday bus stops, and we're working with an architect to try to put the thinking into the architectural structures. What you see here is an extension of a bench, which we call a puzzle bench, especially cool for families that don't have the blocks. Don't have the puzzles, and I just told you how important that is, that play is for young kids, we can put it right at our bus stops and allow the kids to succeed that way. This could be in front of a hospital. And maybe if it were in front of a hospital where people come, where people wait, where people go to clinics, we could change the way clinics look. Over here, just to show you another example, this is an upside down umbrella structure on top of a light. But when it's on that street light and you turn it, guess what happens? Animation on the street below. Think about it. How can we change our environments? Oh, I should have mentioned, this is Itai Palti, who designed this stuff with me, and Brenna Hassinger-Das, my postdoc, who's also working with me on this project. We can go into supermarkets and hospital clinics, and we're doing this around the world. We're encouraging that kind of conversation that isn't existing otherwise. Did you know that grocery stores are not just for buying food? Do you know that there's learning in those aisles? Just by putting up signs that said silly things like, hi, I'm a cow. Did you know milk comes from a cow? What else comes from a cow? We got 33% more language. from adults to children with the signs up than we got with the signs down. We similarly tried these little teeny sign things in hospital clinics where kids go with their parents, where they are waiting, and we're getting the same kind of increases. Is that amazing? We can change our whole environment to help learning. So, maybe we can use the grid in our offices. Maybe doctors can say not just how many words does your kid have, and let's look at their height and weight, but maybe we can also say, so what are we doing for collaboration? What are we doing for communication? Let's go through and see what it would look like in collaboration. Couldn't we ask, are your children in a play group? That'd be a pretty reasonable question to ask a family. Or we might ask, how much time are you and your children spending in front of screens? Notice I said you and your children, not just your children, for communication. Do you guys have a family dinner? Are you sitting down and having conversations at your family dinner? Are you perhaps picking up your kid from school, asking what's going on in the school day, and helping them figure out what's going on in the school day? Because if you ask your kid, what happened in school today, what's the answer?
Nothing.
But if you look at that list, you know, you get from the school with the kids' names on it, you know that one? Okay? If you say things like, oh, I heard Jenny was playing with the paints today. No, Mom, it wasn't Jenny, it was Chloe. You already know what's going on in that classroom. And you don't need to go that far. Just ask a lot of questions. Use particulars, and you'll start getting more communication. For content, maybe you'd like to try Baby Math. Baby Math turned out to be a really cool program. It was a publication that came out in Science earlier this year. Fun stuff by Sion Baylock of University of Chicago, Susan Levine, University of Chicago. Cool stuff. Instead of just reading books, you can read about math and have math games. Wow. For content, are you giving children problems to solve, like a Lego castle? And are they building Brio train tracks? Are you discussing the issues of the day? Are you asking questions? And are your children asking questions? Do they know that water gets higher when you put the ice cube in their class? Are we asking those questions of our kids? I used to take some of the problems of the day, like when they had oil spills. I always used to, believe it or not, I would take it to my 6-year-olds and 7-year-olds. I'd say, hey guys, what do you think we can do to shut off the valve in the Gulf? The adults aren't figuring it out. Maybe you can. Or maybe you'd like to help design the park that's going in outside of the hospital. What should it look like? What would you like in it? And that builds the kind of critical thinking skills. And then you can talk about, maybe that can't go on there because there's a hill. You could even go out then and say, let's walk the land and see if there are hills there. See where we can put up something and where we can't. For creative innovation, are your children doing something like the Maker's Fair? Oh, you don't even need to go to the real Maker's Fair. You just need toilet paper rolls. You need to not throw out your cartons. You need to keep your yarn. You need to let them explore. I remember one day, Josh was looking at a stuffed animal that a friend of mine had actually painfully made for him. And when I went into his room, the stuffing was all over the floor, all over the floor. And I decided I could have been really mad about the mess, you know. But I had to clean up the mess, whether I was mad about it or not. I mean, it was all over the floor. And I said to Josh, well, I can see you learned something about stuffed animals today. What did you learn? And he said, oh, there's all this stuff inside. And I said, well, let's see if we can put it back inside the stuffed animal. What did we learn instead? We learned that stuffed animals are made from the smushy stuff that you can put back into the stuffed animal. For confidence, this is a biggie. Are we letting our kids climb? Are we letting our kids go outside? Are we praising our kids for their effort and not just saying to them, wow, you're so amazing, you deserve a trophy, okay? Because they're not going to learn as well if we just compliment them all the time and we don't praise them for their effort. So I'd like to suggest that maybe the 6 C's could be a kind of chart for all of us. Maybe we could take it home. Maybe we can ask ourselves how to build our homes, our classrooms, our environments, so that we're building a whole And maybe, just maybe when we do, we'll find out that play is one of the ways to help our kids grow all of these skills. I'd like to suggest that the six C's is a framework. It's one of many frameworks, but I think it's a framework that will help our kids learn the very skills that they need to be happy, healthy kids today and to be responsible citizens and good workers of tomorrow. What I showed you in that grid comes from a field called the science of learning. It's a relatively new field. It's an amalgamation of what's going on in psychology and education, in communication sciences, in the sciences, in our understanding of STEM learning. All these have come together to form what we're calling the science of learning. And these skills are the ones where there's the most consensus and the most build in our field. In that book, then, we suggest the traditional way is no longer the way we ought to be raising and educating our kids. In the 21st century, what we really need are kids who are happy, healthy, kids who are caring, kids who are social, who care about other human beings, like what I saw modeled here today. We need kids who are thinkers. Yes, we do. But that's not all they are. They are not Mr. Spock. They are real people. Real people who come to us with personalities. They come to us with emotions. They come to us with undying determination and curiosity. And we sometimes put them in environments that beat that out of them. Let's reignite it. And let's help them become the collaborative, competent, critically thinking, responsible citizens of tomorrow. I believe that we can do it. I believe we can change the lens on how we see that artwork, on how we look at that little kid who's playing King Arthur, and on how we view clapping. It ain't just clapping. It ain't just clapping. It's one way to learn mathematics. Thank you so much. Happy to take questions. I'm happy to take questions if any of you have questions or ideas or thoughts, or if I went too far out in the land. Yeah. Sure. In the schools, yeah, yeah. Yes, yes. I actually think it's precisely, you know, my view of a lot of special needs is that we have tended to use a medical model where we, in a sense, put the kids in a different bin. And I'd rather we move to a model, and I think that the evidence suggests a model where if you think of a normal curve, we all have pieces all over the curve. You know what I mean? And so you may need a little compensatory. Like some kids, if a child is autistic, then we need to help them find new ways to express their collaboration. And in fact, in research I'm doing right now in New York, we're using drama. All right, turns out that it may be, we're not sure yet, but it may be that musical theater is a really wonderful way for helping kids to learn that perspective. And there are some other researchers looking at that as well. So yes, I think it's on the same continuum. It would work in precisely the same way. Your other question is, believe it or not, the harder question, which is how do we begin to penetrate the school system? And I think here we've got to put up a fight. And it's got to be a fight because the teachers are with us, by the way. It is easier, for example, to test whether you know the letters of the alphabet and to see whether you know letter sound correspondence than it is for me to test your vocabulary, okay, and your language scores. It just is easier. The tests are better. So what happened in the schools is everybody jumped to the tests that were there rather than asking what builds strong vocabulary. It happens to be language skills. So don't just find a cheap and dirty test to pull off and then say, this is what we're going to use in our policy. Look at what you need to have and then develop what you want as the accountability for those outcomes. We're getting somewhere. It's slow. And we have no idea where all this is going to go, to be perfectly honest with you. I did not hear education even raised much in the entire debate, which scares the heck out of me. Because, you know, right now, you are looking, your kids are the kids who are going to be running everything in 2040, right? If our education systems aren't good, nothing else is going to matter. They're not going to be able to be the great citizens that we want. So we, I believe, have to band together as ambassadors for education. And it is nationally the number one topic on the top of the list. It actually beats out security. And yet nobody was talking about it. So I don't know what to do except to say that people like me and scientists are now coming out of their holes in the university, starting to talk about it. We know a lot. We know what to do. We can do evidence-based education. We just scream it from the mountaintops. I promise to do my part, and writing the book was my way of putting all the evidence in a readable way so that policymakers could at least grasp it. Sure. Yeah.
Awesome talk. Thank you so much for joining us here in Orlando.
Oh, thank you.
So the urban thinkscape was particularly interesting. I think I've read a little bit of NPR.
Yeah, there was an NPR piece on it, yeah.
Tell me more about that intersection with learning science, where urban design or even interior design, show at the grocery store.
Yeah.
Are we seeing in learning sciences designers like that joining the ranks, or are learning scientists entering those spaces?
Great question. So the question is, where's the marriage between the learning scientists and the architect and designers? The truth is, this is a really new idea. And it seems to be spreading quickly, because I'm going next week to a cities conference as the New York Academy of Sciences decided to pull in cities, because there's a whole movement around rejuvenating cities. A couple of architects have decided they want to join our team and come in on what we're doing. We welcome them with open arms. We welcome cities that want to give all this a try. And what we're trying to do right now is to get some of this mounted. I'm thrilled to tell you the first urban thinkscape per se is going to be up in Philadelphia in May. We are currently piloting some of the designs that you saw. And it's going to be in a small lot in West Philadelphia, which is one of our low-income promise zones. And we were given by one of the churches there the lot where Martin Luther King started his freedom march in 1960. So as a scientist, what we want to do is get the idea out there. It's really important that those of you who might want to play with this work with scientists so that you're really melding it, because it has to be organic. The design must be organic, and it must be real. It has to show off some of the science that we know that promotes learning. But once you got that in the equation, then the game is to test it. See if people use it differently, use that lot and that bus stop differently pre and post when the designs are up. And if you find it works, then we'll publish the paper, and then boom, we hope to put it up on a website to say, these are the designs we tested. Please add to the banquet of choices, and let's make it happen so cities all over start to change their composure and start to organically influence learning. Yeah. Yeah, well, I mean, you know, it's funny. As I said to you, I use these same principles in my college classroom. So I believe it goes all the way up to the boardroom. I always talk about these as the sandbox to the boardroom. Most of the research is with little people at this point. But, you know, there have been examples. I'll give you two.
One is in the college level. Everybody's talking about flipped classrooms. Have you heard about it? Flipped classrooms. Why flipped classrooms? Well, it came out of some findings that I think Eric Mazur from Harvard was one of the first. He was teaching physics at Harvard, no less. And he found out that when he taught the course at Harvard, at the end of the day, he'd give an exam, and the kids who took the exam, you know, adolescents and college kids, didn't know whether a heavier object fell faster than a lighter object, or they didn't. All right, now if you can't answer that after Physics 101 in a college course at Harvard, there's a problem, okay? There's a problem here. So the result was it ended up in this flipped classroom idea of really having more agency, or dare I say, playing more in the classroom where you're doing the experimenting in the classroom. Learn the lectures at home, but stop treating people like they're empty vessels just to be, you know, so the stuff is thrown into the empty vessel in the mind of a person. We have to have more respect for people. And for adolescents in particular, I think especially kids who have never had that respect, never had that ability, when they create something, they're triply proud of it. And we need to give them the chance to show that off, to work with someone else, to have something positive come out of it. So I think you want to keep the constrained part of constrained tinkering, but I think you want to have the tinkering piece so that they can't get in trouble with their tinkering, but they can develop something that allows them to have voice and vision. Yeah. You know, near and dear to my heart.
What is your advice in speaking with parents? A lot of my kids with language delay is because of their home environment.
Yeah.
It's the screen time. My home exercise program is get on the floor and play with the trains. And they're like, yes, get on the floor and play. And it's just so shocking to them.
So shocking to them.
And so what is your advice?
Oh, right. That's my favorite answer is, but they really love it. Of course they do. I love candy. I mean, are you just serving them candy for their main meal? Okay? I mean, that's the answer. No, look, it's a very serious question. And part of what we have to do, I think, sometimes is show it, not tell it. Okay? So you may be talking to them and go, oh, I'm sorry, I just got a text from it. Just a second. Yeah. Now, I will tell you that I had a funny experience with my middle son. We had dinner recently, and he kept pulling out his phone. And he did it in a way that he thought I wouldn't notice. You've all done this, right? You pull it out like this. It's under the table, right? Like, nobody knows what's going on here. Because you can't tell. So finally, I texted him. And I texted him, and I said, hi, Mom here, other side of table. Wouldn't mind having a conversation. So that's part of it, is show it. Because when they see it, they know it's rude, okay? But when you tell them, they don't know it's rude. They don't get it. Okay, another thing that you can do is ask a simple question. Could you spend 2 minutes a day looking into the eyes of your child? Now, I tried 10, people told me no, too long, okay? I tried 5, too long, can't do it. 2 they can take. Put everything away, turn your cell phone off, 2 minutes. And that too will grow. And they'll learn how to do it. Sorry, that's my
suggestion. And I just have one more thing. In any of your research or in any of the trials that you've done, have you ever tried doing like a lending library of just toys and materials? We have a lot of families who just don't have access to books, to simple cars and trains.
Absolutely.
And has it been successful? Have the parents been, you know, open to that?
Parents are super open to it. And parents just, I mean, they love getting this stuff. Reach Out and Read is the best example from pediatricians. I mean, what's it, 4.5? No, it might even be more than that. It might be 6 million people reach. It's like huge. And parents love getting these books, and they use them with their kids. So I think you have a great idea here. And if you're doing toy lending, same idea, you know? Just say, hey, we have something for you. Take it home. See what you think of it. You know, give us your opinion. Again, anything we can do to value them.
And if it, you know, if pediatricians would start doing this, or believe it or not, barbershops and nail salons. I know that sounds crazy, but I'm in a position right now where I believe we need to go where the people are. I think we have misjudged. I'll give you an example, another quick story out of Chicago. There's a wonderful woman there who claims to have taught the President Obama and Michelle community organizing. And if you met this woman, I promise you would believe her, okay? And she said to me, when I walked in, this woman was sitting in a very commanding way at a table, and she said, "Well, what do you think?" Now, she has her place in South Chicago. You've been hearing about all the murders going on in Chicago? She's in South Chicago, let me tell you, this place. She got a warehouse in South Chicago, and that's where her office is. She goes, "What do you think?" So I looked at her, and I thought, it's an opportunity. I said, "They're not coming." She stood up. She said, "They're not coming." I said, "They're not coming." She said, "Well, you're right." And I said, "Yeah?" She said, "Yeah. They just built a beautiful clinic. Some man, he donated a beautiful clinic down the street. Millions of dollars he threw into this architecture because he thought everybody'd be running to the clinic because it's right there in the neighborhood. But they're not coming. But they're going to the barbershop. They're going to the nail salon. Right? They're sitting at the bus stop. They're riding in the buses and the subways. We need to be there. And if we put our toy lending there, in places that are not threatening, that are safe, where I bring my kids, what are we doing with laundromats? We ought to be having a field day with laundromats. All right? Our hospital clinics ought to be bursting with opportunities and giveaways because people sit and wait there. So I think you're on to a great idea. Now let's go where the people are. And not in a place where we preach to them, but in a place where it organically comes out of the everyday moments of their busy lives. They want to do well by their kids. Our job's to help figure out how. All right, thank you guys.
I'd like to present you with the trophy.
Oh my gosh, thank you. Oh my gosh, that's so nice. Wow, thank you.
You're welcome.
So sweet, thank you.
Thank you everyone for coming.
Yeah.